Hi, welcome to the session titled CO.L.T, a College Level Faculty Development Model to Improve Online Education. And our presenters here is Brian Redmond, Evans Quinns, and Larry Borges. Let's welcome them.
Hi, everybody. Ooh, that's bright. So welcome to the session. Obviously, you came here if you're interested in the CO.L.T. You probably saw the cheesy little joke I told on the elevator speech. I obviously wanted a horse in the idea, in the College of Liberal Arts. It's a funny idea, I thought, but it's cheesy anyway. But anyway, so I'll just quickly start. We do have a back channel TLT CO.L.T. if you want to participate in that way. You know, if anybody's shy or just wants to participate in conversations behind the scenes, feel free. So a quick agenda. We're not going to have a whole lot of slides today. This is an open conversation. But there's just some background that we want to give you guys to help foster that conversation. All right, so we'll just go through introductions. Then again, I said as an overview of the CO.L.T, kind of a development of the group, and then we'll open it up to the conversation. So who is involved? I'll go through the list here and let everybody introduce themselves. Thomas, do you want to start off?
So, do you want us, me also to give the impetus behind this?
Sure, why not?
Okay. So, first of all, I'm going to ask how many administrators are in the room? It's a lovely job, can I say. So, I'm the assistant dean of the College of the Liberal Arts, and my job is to oversee the college's outreach and online education portfolio. My job is purely administrative. It's distinguished from our learning design unit, which is headed by Kathy Halsinger. We have one of our great learning designers, Ross, back in the room. But the problem we have in the college is that we have a huge portfolio that is decentralized by academic department. And what we want, in addition to growth, is we want to be known for quality. So we had an earlier effort to work with department heads in the units that had online programs. And what we found there is that the differences in interest in the department heads was vast, and that a lot of the department heads were too far removed from the online operations to really be impacted significantly by what we were doing in that group. So we thought the best way to make an impact would be to engage the administrators, the academic administrators, who work the most with faculty. And so that was really the emphasis of the group. We didn't want to replicate faculty development because Larry's group does such a great job with that, and our learning designers also do a fair amount of faculty development. So we wanted to make our impact on essentially a train-the-trainers model. So that was the beginning of the idea, and then I thought, well, I can't do this. I don't have the time. And what you know as an administrator is that your job is really to find really good people to do the work and to provide them the resources and the infrastructure to do that. And so then I contacted Brian and Larry.
Hi, I'm Larry Borges, and I'm Director of Faculty Development for World Campus and also an Assistant Professor in Education Leadership. So the concept of CO.L.T. will unfold in a few minutes. I think what's important in terms of context is this is a really interesting example of what I would call sort of an indirect initiative towards faculty development. So instead of working directly with faculty, CO.L.T. works with the administrators of online programs who work with faculty. And oftentimes there's a disconnection there because faculty who are online instructors know a lot about that. They have a lot of experience and they sort of know sort of nuts and bolts about how courses are put together, programs are put together, but often because of administrative reasons that are completely understandable, sometimes folks who are overseeing or administering online courses have never gone online, have never seen an online course. And so, and oftentimes those folks have that responsibility in addition to a number of other pieces of administrative responsibilities. And so it can be a little overwhelming. So World Campus Faculty Development has an opportunity to do something we haven't really done before, which is in a structured, formal organization that we've established with C.O.L.T, to do indirect faculty development by helping to support the learning and the ongoing knowledge of online program administrators.
So I'm the last member of the team. I'm Brian Redmond. I'm a faculty in the Department of Psychology. I teach exclusively online and have done so for the past 8+ years now, which is a very unique position even in our large department where we actually have 27 full-time instructors who teach online, but most of them are split loads. I've been teaching online now for a dozen years or so. I've taught over 100 sections of online courses, developed a ton as well. So when Avis approached me about this, I was really excited because I've been doing a lot of idea sharing, building bridges within our department. So I was really excited to jump on the chance of sharing ideas and resources and innovation opportunities across departments within the college. This was something that was very interesting to me. You know, why reinvent the wheel has always been my kind of idea with this is, you know, there's lots of great things going on in all these different departments. They can spend time innovating on other new ideas rather than reinventing the wheel again. Psychology's done something great. There's no reason that, you know, history has to redo that. Same and vice versa. So I'll also give a shout out to all the other supervisors that are involved in this. There's a variety of them. In fact, I'll probably scroll through here a little bit and you can see, you know, we serve a bunch of different online programs. They're all obviously all within the College of Liberal Arts at this point. And there's more being added. Okay. Right now, we currently have about 20. This data is a little old. This is actually 6 months old, but it's, we have about 20 coordinators involved who supervise about 150 faculty, which has a pretty broad scope as far as the courses that we're covering. Okay. And again, growing. As the College of Liberal Arts portfolio of online education is growing as well. All right, so our goals, again, is to work with these coordinators to improve online learning and teaching. Again, as Avis and Larry both mentioned, it's basically about training the trainers, so to speak. But it's not just training the trainers. It's not, you know, like, here's a skill to do, take it back to your teachers so that they can use it in their classrooms. It's getting them to think about all sorts of different problems and issues at a broad array of levels. You know, from the instructor level to the program level and then maybe up to the college level depending on what their needs are. So the format that we take are these primarily these springboard sessions. All right, within that, what that means is we meet for 2 hours during over lunch once a semester, face-to-face, sit down around a table and have a conversation. People conference call in if needed. People bring in their issues to discuss. We have themes within each session, but people are bringing their real-world experiences and their ideas to share in those sessions, okay? So Larry and I and Avis, you know, lead these discussions to kind of keep them on track so they don't get back into just complaining about academic integrity or just complaining about students. Or it's, we keep them, try to keep them on topic as best as possible. We have tried a supplemental webinar at this point. That's, we've done that once. It's a kind of a more of a how-to as opposed to a problem-solving type of session. And that one was addressing instructional design. Oh, I just went over all this.
So, would you go back to the department list? So if you look at this, I wanted to just explain why we chose it. We actually know the College of the Liberal Arts has about 186 courses, most of them running with multiple sections. So the amount of faculty who were involved in this effort is really enormous. And when we thought, how are we going to best approach this so we have the most impact, we went for the programs, the department that are actually offering an online program. because we then had the most courses and the most faculty. And then after that, we went with the departments that had the largest general education portfolios. And what was interesting about this was this is the first time that some departments had to think about, well, who am I going to send to this meeting? I have never really designated anybody with the responsibility of supervising the online faculty. Now, it may be somebody's responsibility as an undergraduate officer, for example, to supervise all faculty, but they haven't really thought about what are the specific issues with a mix of full-time faculty like Brian who are here, but you also have faculty who are at a distance. Although the college, outside of one program, the college is very much moving towards having most faculty who teach online courses have a blended workload. And that was deliberately because of quality control. And so it was also better for the faculty, they have a better sense of community, they're not feeling isolated. But what we found out in this first meeting after the departments decided who should come, psychology sent three or so ahead of the curve, they sent many, and one department came thinking it was kind of a different discussion. But once we sort of got everybody around the core concept of this is really your role as an administrator and understanding the parameters of what it's like to develop faculty to teach in an online environment. Then we started having conversations like, we never thought of that. We don't do any of this. We don't onboard. And so I think one of the difficult things was for us to level the conversation where you've got some departments, and I'm going to point to psychology, are very mature about what they're doing. English is very mature. And how many of you know what a 602 course is? Okay, so it is?
The dissertation research one?
Well, the course is run by the department for their instructors and graduate students and how to teach. And so English was they've been thinking for a long time, how do we adapt this for also teaching online? Because it's becoming more and more of an enterprise within a lot of college and liberal arts in particular. We have a very large portfolio. Revenue was over $16 million last year. And that's a huge business operation, but behind that business operation, a lot of workers, in the knowledge industry, and how are they really becoming the best? So I just wanted to point out, at that first meeting, once departments decided who they should send and what the conversation should be, then I think we really need to move ahead.
Yeah, so this points to an example of the springboard model that Brian mentioned. So. Every program in the college is sort of structured a little differently. So there's no, you can't streamline things by suggesting everybody have the same structure. And I'm not even sure that streamlining is good because the differences in complexity sometimes yield better results than having kind of a streamlined, simplistic approach. So. Program infrastructure became a topic. Best practices became a topic. And so what we started doing is identifying the topics that were surfacing in these conversations, and we designed the springboard model. The springboard model means in a two-hour period, we would probably devote or try to center conversations around one main topic. Let's say best practices, that was our first session. And then after we make a transition, we begin to talk about another big topic, but in just sort of broad brush ways. And that would be the last half an hour. With the idea that then folks would go back and have the conversation about that smaller topic, generate all the questions, determine sort of what the problems are, what the strengths are. And then when we came back, that little, the smaller topic would springboard into becoming the main topic of the next session. So we have session two sessions every year. And that's proved to be a kind of interesting model because we send folks back, hopefully having a good acquisition of knowledge and understanding and context of the big topic, but realizing there's lots of other topics down the road. So the springboard then becomes a good opportunity to then expand. And what we have found is, as we try to design what the next springboard is, we sometimes get it right. Like they want to come back and talk about that topic, and then sometimes another topic will emerge within the next, in between the 3 months or 4 months that we meet. And we're flexible with that. But the concept of the springboard is something that we think is worth pursuing.
Yeah, that's been highly successful with that, as I have up here, that homework assignment. For instance, we were talking about evaluation in one of the springboard topics, and the homework assignment was, for next time, what has your department done to improve evaluation since last we met? And that led to some really great conversations when evaluation became the main topic this last time. People started to think about it in between and prepare for the meeting. So they weren't just like at the last minute cramming something together, as we're all known to do when there's a deadline.
Yeah, the other point is that most of these people are in a position to bring about change on the department level. I can talk to department heads a lot. And that, you know, department head will often walk away from that meeting with really good intentions, but just runs into a million other items. So if your responsibility, say, of the undergraduate officer or the associate head, that the money coming in from this portfolio is your job, that complaints about academic integrity is your job, grade adjudication is your job, and then a lot of those issues really directly correspond to the quality of your faculty development. So that's really why that level of person is really important.
So just as an example of the topics that we've talked about, again, this kind of shows you the structure of the springboard. You know, we started off with best practices in teaching just because it was something people could jump into really easily. And then we jumped into our onboarding was our springboard that then became the main topic for the next session. Now, I want to talk quickly about the evolution of this group as well. This group started off back in October 2013 as kind of a very formal presentation. Larry and I each had some slides, and we, you know, followed them, you know, very closely. And it was good. I mean, luckily, I think what we did that was really successful is in this we had an activity. All right, and in that activity, it was a problem-solving activity where people broke into groups and discussed these best practices within their own department. And Larry, Avis, and I jumped down into those groups. So it became very peer-oriented conversations rather than very top-down, very quickly. And that peer discussion made everybody feel very comfortable, I think, we have input into this process. We can, you know, shaped where this group goes, and I think that was really key.
Brian, and I'll get back. The comfort also was being able to say to your peer in another program, I don't know what I'm doing, or I had no idea. So there was a safe disclosure setting that we created.
Yeah, that's absolutely it. The comfort level got very quick. And these were people who didn't know each other before. They were operating in separate silos, each department doing their own thing, not really knowing each other at all. So it went from that very formal first session to, even by our second one, an open conversation. You know, we had some slides that second time. I don't think we used more than two of them. The conversations got that in-depth and that good right off the bat because people felt comfortable and safe with each other. All right, so now we'll open it up to conversation. You know, what do you want to know about this process?
So are you still doing it at the department level, or are you doing it at the program level? Because when I think about who the candidates would be at my college, the College of Education, it wouldn't be at the department level, because I would be the one for my program, and in my department there are three more of me. So if deciding among the four of us who would be the coordinator would take more time than just sending all four of us to go to the thing. So I'm not sure.
Well, so the reason we have a mix in the liberal arts is because we have a big general education portfolio, and those are and so when Brian said we're talking about expanding, so there were some departments that have one course. And at that point, you know, we were feeling our way with this, and we didn't invite them. But now we'll be, you know, expanding it. We'll be inviting everyone. Your point about some departments sending more than one person is because there will be people with different roles. And as I said, psychology frequently sends more than one person. How many students do you have in that?
Well, we have a lot. I mean, we have about 1,000 enrollments. Okay. So we have a lot of faculty who are responsible for a lot of different things. You know, we have, you know, one online faculty who's in charge of mentoring and one online faculty who's in charge of evaluation. We have a couple different things that are covered. So it makes sense. And actually, I think it helps to have people from different levels and different roles attend a session like this, because then you get multiple perspectives on how to solve a problem.
I think you raise an interesting question. I'm in the College of Education, and it's structured differently in some ways in liberal arts. And so as this concept is unfolding, one of the questions is, should other colleges come into this model? Because it's very liberal arts kind of focused in terms of that. Or should the College of Education start its own CO.L.T. version? And by the way, I'm volunteering in terms of World Campus Faculty Development. Anybody who wants to start anything, contact me, LBB150, and I'm happy to spread my my unit as thin as possible. So there's a question of, based on how each college works, is it better to have a college-focused one? Not that we want to differentiate, but certainly, and I've learned a lot about the College of Liberal Arts, because the conversations are very liberal arts-oriented in terms of their sets of issues. College of Education may have a whole other set of issues, as will other colleges too. So that's something to sort of consider in joining or starting something else. What would really be interesting is if there were several different cults, let's say, and they began to function well within, what would it be like to then have sort of like a seminar of all the different cults together? What would that look like, and what would people talk about? I don't know, but we're at the stage where this thing is just evolving.
The other thing to note about the liberal arts is it's really multiple disciplines. And so we've already noted different conversations when someone from English is at the table, because that's two disciplines. Right there, you've got the rhetoricians. In CAS, you've got rhetoricians and social scientists. We have not yet involved the language people, because we thought that is such a totally different conversation. But we're probably now going to include those. And we may even have some subgroups. So we could have the rhetoricians meet, we could have the language people meet, because some of those concerns are a little bit different. But the responsibility of the administrator is still pretty much the same.
Sure.
I forgot the humanists. and the social scientists.
Can you talk a little bit about that, the relationship, interplay, whatever, of the instructional designers and the faculty?
Within each department or
well, just
across?
With respect to this whole goal that you have of, you know, kind of developing faculty.
Yeah. At
where do the instructional designers fit into that?
Well, we have one of our learning designers, Rocks, back there, but I would say that's, if you look at life cycle of this process, that's probably a different level. And again, that's with faculty. not with the administrator. Ross, I'm going to call on you to talk about what you do with faculty when you're developing a course.
It's really a sort of evolving and progressive conversation between myself and the faculty member, given that everybody's online experience is different as far as their teaching experience online and their actual sort of teaching style. So what I try to do is to find where everything comes together and intersects, their particular teaching style and their approach to content, their comfort with online learning, and then finding the balance where they're most comfortable. Hopefully I'm trying to get them to move toward their, I'm a little worried about that edge, okay, move you a little bit out of the comfort zone. And try to accommodate that sort of as a best case scenario when we're presenting online materials. Does that respond to your question?
Yeah, it sounds like you're doing it kind of one-on-one. I guess what I'm interested in, and maybe it's just not part of this conversation, is this whole notion of branding and image and, you know, kind of knowing. You know, we have this goal now that when you go to a world campus or you do an online course, that you know you're at Penn State and that you affiliate with Penn State. And, you know, that there's some sort of, shall we say, design characteristics or user learning experience, student experience, or whatever, that does, you know, come across. And I'm just wondering, you know, if instructional designers are primarily focused on modules, content modules, and, you know, how to put this, that, there, then that is more of a one-on-one thing. But there might be a purview for a broader, you know, more like framework-y thing, right? Whether it's a Google or Angel or Canvas or, you know, whatever it is. And that, I'm just trying to figure out, because if I was a faculty member, which I'm not at the present time, I would love to have tools.
Yeah, and I think, To address some of your point here is that Kathy Holsing, who's the director of instructional design in the College of Liberal Arts, is a representative on this and has been actually at every meeting. So that is a consideration in this process. It's not that the instructional designers are not heard at all in this process. In fact, they're key roles. Kathy's been a very key role. We also have faculty who kind of serve both roles. We have Dan Tripp in English who kind of does their instructional design in English as well. And then we have in other departments, there's various kind of versions of that as well. So that is a key component here as well. We do want our administrators to be informed about that process because I do agree with you that the branding is incredibly important.
I do think one of the ideas that differentiates sort of what CO.L.T. is designed to do is level of decision making. Okay, so the faculty and instructional designers are making a certain set of decisions, but at the program level, the program leads and the faculty leads, and sometimes they're blurred. They seem to be making a separate set of decisions, and maybe more of a higher level set of administrative decisions. And we haven't really articulated that, or we don't have a typology of, if you make these sort of sets of decisions around your online program, you should belong to CO.L.T., but if you make these other sets, you should be working with faculty. Again, that's an evolution about at what level of decision making are we trying to impact programs with CO.L.T.
Yeah, I wanted to talk about the branding issue. It's like, had the very good fortune of having come to the College of the Liberal Arts when it was made the decision to shut down most of its correspondence courses because they were, it was not strategic, it was very idiosyncratic to faculty members, and those from the World Campus know well the transition from the correspondence, open enrollment, 8th and 6th month period, was kind of educating Rita online. And then the college became very deliberate about what it wanted to do. It wanted to be a player in the world campus. The first degree program the college could go for, which is multidisciplinary because it came out of the dean's office. When, and this is all about modeling, this is all about developing a culture. And then the World Campus approached the college about, it'd be great to have psychology in mind. Psychology wasn't really convinced at the beginning of this, that this was something they wanted to play, and so I honed my greatest trait, which is persistence. eventually they got in line, but then what happened there was really magical, and it's really what you want to see when you talk about cultural change. Rich Carlson fully embraced the academic ownership of that degree. And he has really helped set a lot of the standards that the other departments are now learning to follow. So each department, not only disciplinary based, but size and, you know, the context, they all have their different cultures, but they're all very centrally interested in this has got to be the same quality that we have in our resident program. And so one of the transitions we made relative to faculty, once upon a time faculty, the department heads looked at the correspondence stuff as something very separate. And so one question I would have for them, is this a faculty member you would appoint to teach down the hallway from you? And they went, well, no. And we said, well, okay, then we don't want that. So we've had to be very involved with quality, building faculty capacity. And so these are all decisions. Part of the onboarding is also a faculty retention issue. So we're very aware we want these to be the College of the Liberal Arts courses and programs. And everyone's very mindful. You may only have one course with 30 students, but those 30 students are extremely important as a population that we serve. So I don't know.
That helps. And I, see, we're kind of at the opposite. I'm from information sciences technology, so we're like a little college. We don't have departments, right? So we really are like one big department.
Yeah.
So it's a lot easier for us to manage everything, right? Because we just don't have all that. And so, like, one of our big foci has been integration across the Commonwealth, right? So we don't need to worry so much about integration in our college because we're kind of inherently integrated by design. But we're very interested in our, you know, 20 sister campuses. Mm-hmm. And in fact, and I don't know if this is true for you guys at all, a lot of our online teaching is done through those collaborations with the campuses. Mm-hmm. Do you have that? Or is it all done with University Park faculty?
Well, in liberal arts, we are part of a couple inter-college programs, like Homeland Security. We have some core courses. Yeah, we have some core courses in that. We're looking at inter-college programs now, but it's, you know, it's the low-hanging fruit thing. I mean, we went because we're so big.
Yeah.
It was just easier to go forward with our own programs. In the consulting stage, we've offered collaboration with some different campuses. You know, we've offered that, but mostly we're collaborations in the future. But there, that would be.
Yeah, I'm thinking more like that. You know, they're like some of our most expert online educators are distributed across the state, which adds a whole interesting dimension because you couldn't go, at least not conveniently, to a sit-down meeting like this, but of course we do have constant interaction.
Right. I think there's a lot more attention to the campuses from our unit in terms of trying to what we call deliver faculty development out there.
Yeah, yeah.
And also David Stone, who's in working with the collaborative programs. So I think that the university's a lot more aware of that, and also the potentially positive role of online education for those campuses, you know, as they're dealing with their residential enrollment issues.
Right.
There's a question over here.
Yeah, you mentioned the quality of courses. I'm curious how you're defining and measuring quality. Most of the conversations I've heard or comes up with concern of quality of online education comes out of the mouths of people who have never taken or taught an online course, and most times can barely manage their inbox. And when you're talking about literally a global reach and going across, people are learning differently. Think about the keynote speech we just heard, lecturing, don't absorb. I saw something recently online where they went to kids and showed them technology. It's not so old, but asked them to describe, and they gave them a 3.5-inch floppy disk, and one kid said, oh, somebody 3D printed the save button. They have no concept of what was before. So it really is different. So how do you define the quality of an online course? How do you
Well, yeah, I'll just open up. So one of our last conversations with the CO.L.T. group was an evaluation. And that's on several different levels. One is on, so what makes a quality course? It's the technology, it's the course design, it's the preparedness of the teacher. In doing that, so there are multiple levels. Ross, do you want to talk about the mid-course, the course evaluation level, because this is one dimension.
One thing that we do is we insert the survey exactly the same as a mid-course evaluation, and basically we elicit feedback from the students to get information, not necessarily on from the teaching process, but on the learning environment itself, so that we as designers can improve the efficacy and the interest and engagement for the students who are involved in the course. We look at these, of course, I mean, as a designer, I'll go in and I look at the feedback that I get for a course, and then I keep that in mind as we update the designs. Of course, so we try to sort of factor in that continuous improvement piece respective to all the courses that we teach.
Yeah, so I think the sort of online teaching is a team sport, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, it requires the instructors, instructional designer, requires the technical piece, and I think each of those team members have their own articulations of excellence. So what's excellence in an instructional designer? Any instructional designer would be able to come up and give you the top five qualities. Faculty development, we're able to say, we know what quality and excellence and effectiveness in online instruction looks like, and it's the demonstration of a set of competencies that are research-based. So we each have our own mantra of quality. I think the interesting conversation, particularly for a university, is to say, okay, let's blend all of those together and come up with sort of a mission statement of quality that has to do with the most appropriate use of the digital interface to help student achieve certain learning outcomes that lead to that student satisfaction and success, or something like that. And that's a great conversation to have, because then you really get into the guts of what's great design, what's great content, what's great pedagogy, and those things can sort of meld and weld into a motto almost, or this is my elevator speech about what Penn State online quality looks like. And then you can start unpacking it and breaking it down depending upon the kinds of conversations.
To follow up, this was actually a conversation that we had on Tuesday when we met last, is evaluation of different levels, faculty, course, program evaluation, and what does quality mean within those. There is obviously the Penn State way kind of thing that, everybody strives for, but what we're striving for in these CO.L.T. meetings is to allow departments to just think about these. So, some of their smaller departments, say anthropology, has never thought about these because they've only got a course or two, so they're not measuring in qualities per se. An established program like psychology's developed measures already to assess faculty, to assess courses and the program as well, trying to meet these mission statements for the department. is one of the things that we're trying to strive for in this conversation is, you know, set these quality standards for your department, you know, and then measure that so that we, you know, you have strong faculty who are striving towards your mission. You know that your courses are meeting your program goals, these types of conversations. This program is really kind of set up to get administrators who may not have been thinking about quality in the past to really start thinking about quality. And we're focusing on evaluation in this little conversation here, but that was the goal with onboarding, with best practices in teaching and all these other things is, you know, we're trying to improve quality across through this idea of idea sharing and resource sharing. You know, for instance, the quality matters rubric that everybody uses across the university. You know, one department adapted that to help meet their specific program goals on how to evaluate their courses. They then are now sharing that with other departments, so the other departments aren't going to just adopt it, and say that this is what we're going to use. That's, we're now going to innovate this for our department so that it fits our needs, and we can, we as the experts in online teaching in this specific field, that's quality by our standards, and that's how we're going to assess it. I think we'll go over to Andrea, and then we'll come back.
I just wanted to say, I think, to the question about quality and to the other questions, one of the things that's so important about this is, in terms of online and distance education becoming something that's really within the mainstream of the university proper, so that it's creating these conversations still at this point at the very beginning, that you have a lot of decision makers maybe without a lot of experience in online, and that's not a bad thing, but without creating this community of practice, you don't necessarily have a shared understanding that these are real Penn State students, this is a real Penn State education. Like your question of would you want this person teaching down the hall from you, then why would you hire them to teach online? That's relatively new in terms of the history of DE and online at Penn State. It's always been this thing out there. And this really is a huge step towards it being part of the core departments that you were in, that quality matters, the students matter, teaching excellence matters. So I think it ties all that together really well.
And I think that, you know, the average faculty member would say that no matter really how limiting a course design may be, or no matter how limiting the technology, if you're really engaged with the students still really going to have a good educational experience. And I think we're all aware of Angel has had limitations in terms of some of the things that can be done. But if you look at where the I can speak to the liberal arts, that the college has had a dean who really is extremely smart about how to bring about change. She's invested responsibility in the department. She's invested in a top quality learning design unit. We have a small administrative team, and she loves to see this kind of partnerships and, you know, growth with a role like Brian's coming into psychology, where someone can have an office in Moore Building. You know, space is the final frontier of Penn State. We just don't have enough of it. Brian has an office. He teaches totally online. He's fully integrated in his in the IO site group. So we don't quarantine online faculty off somewhere that they can have those conversations. But now we have one exception, which is a professional master's degree over a lot of faculty, and that's a whole other set of challenges which we don't have time to get into.
But that's like 60 faculty who are spread throughout the entire world.
But that department deals with that.
Right, they do.
Yeah.
Paul?
How we talked about instructional design and making the quality courses in terms of instructional design, and having a framework for that. The quality matters. There's Penn State quality assurance standards. That's on the web learning, you know, website and what have you. Is there a framework, you know, for the teaching part of the delivery? Because quality matters. Penn State quality assurance. There's a lot of emphasis on the design of the course and the technology and so on. But what about the actual teaching practices? you know, has there been a conversation yet about?
Well, Tuesday we had some of this conversation, and again, departments are different, and what behaviors they want. Where you can talk to the.
Yeah, let's say it's really a diverse array within from department to department on what they are doing to assess quality as far as instructors go. Excuse me. You know, psychology right from the beginning integrated our online faculty with our face-to-face faculty, so the evaluation process is very much the same. In fact, that's how our degree was marketed, is it's the same Penn State degree from the same exact faculty, that was a really conscious effort that was made by the psych department. Other departments haven't been quite as conscious about that, but they're actually trying to do the same based on these conversations that we've had at the CO.L.T. meetings. They just haven't, it's been an unconscious thought to them. It was like, we want this to be as good as our, you know, face-to-face courses. They haven't necessarily thought about it as much though, which is why these conversations are important. So there's a couple departments who have, you know, designed evaluation of instructors, and they've come up with a certain set of criteria about what's a successful online instructor. For instance, in psychology, I can speak mostly to that one because that's my experience, is that we have a portfolio, you know, that assesses their SRTEs, examples of written communications with students, example feedback, and now we have just added a kind of a more, I won't say quantitative, but we've grown so big now that we have a bunch of brand new instructors who go up for yearly evaluations, that we now have our senior instructors evaluate them through a kind of an interview process, as well as kind of a sitting in their course for a little bit to, you know, see what their interactions are like. And then this all comes together in a portfolio at the end of the year that it's submitted to our associate department head. But other departments do similar types of things on, you know, different types of scales based on where they are in their personal or program development.
So you're developing like tools?
Yes, we are developing tools, yes.
Okay, this suits our context. Okay, some other department, this suits
yes.
our context. But they're encouraged to do that.
Yes,
so
and
that's...
Well, getting back to the 602 model, so Chris Long and I have been talking about what if we encourage the departments to have a 602 nano that would be focused on online, and so there would be more development. So English already does this, for example, but there's a big difference between teaching a composition course with a limit of 24 students and teaching Econ 102 that may have 300. Students, but I say a lot of the behaviors are really what the departments want to see in a residence environment, which is competence in the field. I mean, you've got to be competent in your area. And the second one is the quality of interaction with the student and the quality of evaluation. If I'd pick three.
So those three, like the competency, like the in the way of knowledge of pedagogy, knowledge of content, knowledge of the technology tools. Mm-hmm. To enhance
learning. It's kind of interesting because with Well Campus Faculty Development, we're very focused on specific set of competencies that we build into our OL courses. Mm-hmm. So we talk all the time about pedagogical competencies and technical and administrative competencies. We know what they all are. We have that list. We live and breathe that. But not every online program does. But these ideas of quality, nevertheless, they come up. We call them different things, mm-hmm. but they're basically the same thing. Mm-hmm. So that's sort of encouraging.
So just, I know where we're talking, but one example is we have one department that offers large lectures. And when they hire new fixed-term lectures, they have them come in, and they have the department head, the undergraduate officer, and the associate head watching, now we've hired you, now we want to lecture you, and they critique it. And they say, now we want you to come back and do the lecture again, and these changes. And so they pretty much follow that same model with their online courses. The associate head reviews the course and approves them or asks for changes. And they look at what the performance in the class, online classroom is, and then they say, well, now we want to see.
Are they inside that class of the live version of it?
Yeah.
Oh. And this is really exciting because we're talking about the courses and the education and not just the revenue. And that's what's so important about this, that it's not just these online courses. let us build buildings, let us keep programs going in aspects.
You're absolutely right.
How do we do quality? How should we better teach? I mean, that's what's awesome about it.
But the Penn State secret is quality makes money.
It's just not how we normally talk about it.
Yeah.
So that's very inspiring.
All right. So I do want to thank everybody for coming. I know we're a few minutes over time. You're free to reach out to any of us. I also have business cards here if anybody wants one. You know, we're happy to talk about this and how you might adapt it for whatever your needs are, or come in as a consultant, whatever you need. Thank you for all for coming.
Thank you.